I want to welcome you to the Church Alive Wednesday night Bible study. You know, Sunday I had the privilege of preaching at the church, and we were talking about where does your faith lie? And I want to continue on in that direction, not in where your faith lies, but some of the benefits that God gives us when your faith is in Him and knowing who you are in Jesus Christ. You know, that's something that I struggled with for decades. But when I come to understand what God was saying in His Word about me and to me and for me, it changed me. It changed the way I looked at things. And I want to declare something to you today. And this Christian life that you are living, this game is fixed. And it's fixed in your favor. And you say, well, what are you talking about? I want to read something. I want to read what the Lord gave me here a few weeks ago. And it comes out of 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter and the 13th verse. It says, there hath no temptation taken you, but such is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that you may be able to bear it. Now, Paul just pretty much spelled it out. He said, look, everything that comes against you in this world is common to man, common to most people in this world. You know, you may not have the same things that you deal with that I deal with, but someone does. And God said, look, he said, everything's common to man. Satan can't come at you and try to mess you up and tempt you, hurt you in any way, push you into a place that really you don't need to be or shouldn't be. Satan wants to do that to you. But what Paul is saying to the Corinthians, he's saying, look, all these temptations that come towards you, come against you, are common. They're common to man. And God has made a way for you to overcome it, for you to live triumphant in it. And how is that? Faith in Him. Faith in God. Faith in what His Word says. You know, we go through life, and I talked to a guy this morning at the jail, and this just goes right along with that, with having faith in Him, what it will do for you. But I asked him this morning, I said, listen, I've been asking people around this jail all day. I spoke in three pods this morning, and I asked him, I said, what would you do? I said, if you died today, is heaven your home? And one guy sitting beside me, everybody at the table said, oh yeah, I'm going to heaven. And one of them said, on a jet plane, you know, because he's got a hold of what we're talking about. But there was one sitting next to me. He had been discharged and been turned loose. And when I come back in, I saw him again. I said, what's up, man? He said, I'm in here again. I said, well, what's wrong? He said, well, he said, they said they had a warrant for me. And he said, I come in, I was coming in to pay a ticket. And he said, I paid the ticket. And they said, hold on a minute. They had a warrant for him, and they put him back in jail. And I said, well, I said, the devil will do anything in the world to mess you up. Well, he sat down right beside me. He's heard me over the last few months. He's heard me a lot in there talking about teaching them faith in Him, faith in God, faith in His Word, and believing who they are in Christ Jesus. And it really surprised me what he said. I looked at him. I said, if you died today, and I'm asking the whole table, and I try to make eye contact with all of them. He looked at me and he shook his head no. And I said, what do you mean? I said, you're born again, aren't you? He said, yeah. I said, well, what makes you think if you died today that you wouldn't go to heaven? He said, when they put me back in here, I said some things that I shouldn't have said. And I said, well, let me ask you a question. I said, I want you to get a hold of this now. I said, did you not do what you did? What did you not make Jesus Christ Lord of your life? Did you not confess him and make him Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead? He said, oh, yeah. I said, well, you're born again, right? He said, yeah. He said, I said some things I shouldn't have said. I said, but that don't knock you out of your salvation just because you messed up. He said, well, yeah, I understand what you're saying, but the guilt set in. And it does work for a lot of people. That's what knowing who you are in Jesus Christ can change the way you look at things. And I told him, I went into 1 John 1:9. I said, look, if you sin, confess your sins. He's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. I said, do you believe that? He said, oh, yeah. I said, so if you died today, would you go to heaven? He said, well, yeah. You know, I had to steer him to the Word. And that's the temptation that Satan wants to do everything that he can for us to get focused on. You know, your temptation may not be that. It may be something else. And there's temptations all over the world that Satan has used and abuse people with. But faith in God, faith in what he has said, is one of those things that will completely, completely change the way you look at you. Look at you. I've been on this for a few weeks now about our identity in Christ Jesus. I said, when you look in the mirror, what do you see? What do you see in the mirror? I said, I want you to see a child of God. I don't want you to see your mistakes. Because look, Jesus Christ died to forgive you of those mistakes. He died as payment for those mistakes. And if you've accepted him as Lord and Savior of your life and believe that God raised him from the dead to justify you, God's not holding your iniquities against you. But we have got to get out of a mindset that our screw-ups, the sin that we have lived in for so long, defines us. And it don't. Jesus defines you if you're born again. Jesus defines you. And there's a lot of religion and religious people that argue with you and say, oh no, you know, you've screwed up. You need to beg God to forgive you. No, you need to confess your sins. He's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. See, that's the reason my podcast is named The Prodigal Son, because when I come to the realization of what Jesus was saying in Luke 15, when he was talking about that prodigal son that ran from his home and just done all kinds of craziness and lived out in the world and sinned and wasted his father's living, wasted the inheritance that he had been given. The picture that I see now that I didn't see then was the picture of a heavenly father that loves me, that loved that prodigal son. A picture of that heavenly father that when the prodigal son came home, he didn't condemn him or shame him. You know, Romans 8:1 says, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. But we have to have faith in God that he is true to his word. You understand what I'm talking about? Faith in him that he's true to his word. And I don't know how it hinders so many people. I know how it hindered me over the years because I just didn't believe it. But at Church Alive, we believe what God's Word says. But somewhere in a lot of people's lives, a lot of this entire area that we live in don't believe the way we do. The way people that have faith in God does. That what he has said, we can count on it. And what he has said, he will do, and he'll back it up 100%. But that young man at that jail that had pretty much just said, I'm hell bound. because I said some things that I shouldn't say. I said, you just got mad and got upset, didn't you? He said, yeah. I said, we've all done it. We've all done it. But that don't change the fact of who you have made Lord of your life. I said, you have to have faith in Him, in God, not in your goodness, not in how good you can be and how straight you can walk. I said, if you get in that kind of mindset, I said, you'll stagger and you'll stumble and you'll fall. You will fall flat of your face and fail once again in your Christian life because you're looking at you instead of looking at who you are in Christ Jesus. It takes faith to do that. It takes faith to do that. It takes faith to believe that this game we play called a Christian life is fixed in your favor. Nothing that comes against you is not common for every other man and woman here on this planet. And God has made a way for you to overcome that, for you to bear all that junk that gets thrown at you. How do you do that? Having faith in what He has said. That there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Religion wants to condemn you every day of your life. He wants to shame you into just throwing up your hands and quitting. But I want to read to you what God's Word says, what Paul said in 2 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, and the 4th and the 5th verse. It says, now, we're talking about the temptation that the devil had to use against us, or his weapons that he used to tempt us and mess us over with. But this is what the Lord told us in 2 Corinthians 10 and 4 through Paul. Listen, it says, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. He says, our weapons are not carnal. They're not of this world. They're mighty through God to the pulling down of those strongholds that get in every one of our lives, and we've got to cast them down. Those thoughts, how do you build a stronghold? You build it in your mind. You build it in your mind, and as long as you'll listen to the lies of the devil and he tells you, look, you ain't nothing but who you see in the mirror. You ain't nothing but your screw-ups, your sin. That's a lie. That's a lie of the devil. Don't believe that. Your weapons are not carnal, but mighty through God, through faith in God, through faith in what He has said about you, through faith in what His Word says about you, through faith in not how you feel, but how God has written down all those truths, how you stand in Him. It took me years to work out what I knew to be true about Stacy. I could believe it every day of my life for you or for anybody else in this world. But I struggle with believing it for me. Why? Because I didn't have faith in what he said. I had faith in my feelings, how I felt, because that's how I was trained. That's how I was brought up. You know, don't you feel ashamed for what you've done? Look, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And there ain't no devil in hell, nor religious person, nor any other circumstance going to change my mind about that. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. There's millions out here in this world that walk the streets. There's thousands, tens of thousands of people in this town we live in right now that needs to know what we know as a church that believes God's Word. They need to know that God's for them. They need to know that their weapons as a child of God is not carnal. They're not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. And where does those weapons start to pulling down those strongholds? They start by pulling down those strongholds, those thoughts that the devil has sown in our lives, casting those thoughts down. Listen to what this fifth verse says. It's casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God. In other words, every lie that comes up and says, no, no, that ain't true about what God says about you. No, this is true. Listen, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. In other words, that those weapons that God has equipped us with is the truth in what God has said about us. And it's mighty to the pulling down of all those lies that have got pinned up in people's lives. It took me a long time to wash all that mess out. You know how I washed it out? I kept pouring this in. I kept pouring God's word into it and determining in my heart that I was going to believe it, regardless of how I felt. Regardless of how I felt. I've said this over and over in that jail and places where I've preached all over this town. I've said it. I said, I don't get up a lot of mornings and feel like I ought to be doing what I'm doing. I know I'm called, and that's all that matters. Look. Satan will lie to you and deter you from doing what God has called you to do every day of your life if you allow him. But we have been given the truth in God's word to overcome all those things that are common to man that the devil has to deal with us about. Look, those are easily overcome. I show this picture, and this picture that you're seeing on the screen right now, that is a picture that I wanted to show at church Sunday, because that little rat that you see in this picture, that is what the devil is. He's a defeated foe. And I'm going to tell you something. Jesus beat the brakes off of him. He put him in his place. This picture puts in perspective of how we as Christians should look at the devil and his lies. What does it say? Let me pull it up here where I can read it and get a good. You're seeing it on the screen, but I don't see it in my view of the camera. It says, when we see Satan, we will say, is this the one that was trying to destroy me? A little lying rat. A rat. A liar. I've asked those guys at the jail over and over. I said, if you knew that a person that you was dealing with was a habitual liar that couldn't tell the truth, wouldn't tell the truth, and was doing their dead level best to get one over on you, to hurt you in some way, shape, or form, I said, would you listen at them at all? They said, absolutely not. I said, the devil's a liar and the father of them. Why do we listen to him? Because he's I'll give him this, he's persistent. As long as you'll listen, he'll pound those lies into you till you give in and believe them. Don't do it. Don't do it. Like we was talking about Sunday, faith in God will see you through. Faith in him. Faith in his word. John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. If you're going to believe God, you're going to believe what he says in his word. And if you'll believe what he says in his word, you'll come to a place in your life when the devil stands up and say, look what you've done. Ain't you ashamed? You say, no, I'm not. I screwed up. Father, will you forgive me? Heavenly Father, please forgive me for the sin that I've committed, and confess those sins. And he is faithful and just to forgive you of those sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Sooner or later, the devil's going to quit messing with you. Sure, he's going to come around every once in a while and stick his head up like that rat and try to whisper a lie in your ears. What do you tell him? No. No. What God has said about me is true. You're a liar. I'm a new creature in Christ Jesus, my Lord and Savior. I can stand tall in that. Believe that. Quit trying to have faith in... I don't know how religion has done it, but religion has somehow, some way, made our works the root of our salvation. Our works are not the root of our salvation. Jesus Christ and what He done is the root of our salvation. And faith in Him gave us the privilege to have that salvation, to believe on Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and confess Him as our Lord and Savior with our mouth. Now, our works, what we do to further the kingdom of God, what we do to help someone next door, across the street, one sitting in the church pew beside you, or somebody that you don't even know at the convenience store, at the grocery store. Those works are the fruit of Jesus Christ being Lord of your life and allowing His love to shine through you to somebody else. Like I say, this game is fixed. And you can win it every day of your life if you'll just come to understand that the weapons that God has equipped us with is far bigger than the lies that the devil can tell and will tell to you if you listen. Believe what he has said. Take this book and beat the brakes off of him. I heard a preacher talking about one time. He said, I'd fight the heavyweight champion of the world if somebody else had beat him so severely that he is bleeding out every hole in his head. You know what I'm talking about? The devil has been defeated. You shouldn't allow him to even open his mouth in your presence. When he does, shut him up and tell him who he is. He's a defeated foe. Put him under your feet, where he belongs, and proclaim to the world that you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, your Lord and Savior. If you want to walk victorious in a Christian life, that is what you're going to have to do, is find out what God says in His Word and have faith in Him that what He has said is true. It's true, and having faith in Him will give you the confidence to walk through this life with your head held high and not looking back over your shoulder, worrying about what's going to sneak up behind you. Like that picture, that little lion cub. His mama had his back. Your Heavenly Father has got your back. I promise you that. Ain't a doubt in my mind, God watches over me and my family on a daily basis. I thank God for the truth in what He has said in my life, said for me, about me, and to me. And what He has said to me, He said for you too. He said He wrote this book out. He went to a lot of trouble to give us this book, so that we could know and understand that the game that we're dealing with, the game we're playing, this Christian life that I hear over and over in my life, that how hard it is from other people, that no, this game is fixed and you can win it. You can win it through the truth in what God has said. And believe that word and take that word and proclaim it to the world about yourself. When you convince yourself of it, look here, God don't need convincing, His Word is true. You do. I do. I thank God that He convinces me more and more of that every day, that His Word is true and I can count on it. I can count on it, and you can too. You can count on what God says. Believe in your heart and know without a shadow of a doubt that He's got you. He's got you today. But you got to believe it. You got to take those weapons that are not carnal. I'm talking about but strong through God, through the pulling down of strongholds, and to take those weapons and defeat Satan by casting down all those lies that he wants to throw at you and making them give in. I want to read that one more time. The 10th chapter of 2 Corinthians, 4th and the 5th verse. It says, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ." All those lies that Satan tells you, look here, you can take control of them. You can cast them down and make them give in to obey what God has said. Stand in this. Believe it. Believe it regardless of what you see. Because I'm going to promise you something. We live in a day, in a world, that if you ain't got faith in God, you're going to struggle. You're going to struggle. But faith in Him will put you in a place that you can see literally the world coming apart at the seams and say, "I know without a shadow of a doubt, my God has got this. And I'm going to operate in Him, in His truths, and walk in His truths, and know without a shadow of a doubt that He's going to take care of things." Because He will. I promise you, if you'll put your faith in Him, He'll bring you through things. You'll look back over your life and think, "My goodness, how did I live?" You can say, "By God's grace, His mercy, and faith in Him." God loves you, and He cares for you, wants more than anything for you to live strong in this world, for you to live strong in who He has made you to be in Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior. This game is fixed. Live in that. Live in those truths that the weapons of your warfare are not carnal, but you're going to use them to pull down those strongholds that the devil tries to build in all of our lives. You're going to pull them down through the truth in God's Word. Now, I do this every time I do a podcast or preach at a church. I want to ask you today, if you're listening to this podcast, are you born again? If you died today, is heaven your home? And if you can't say yes, I want to invite you to allow Jesus Christ to come into your heart and into your life and save you. Romans 10:9 says, "If you'll confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, it says you shall be saved." It says, "For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation." That's all it takes to be born again. That's all it takes to be saved. Make Jesus Christ Lord of your life today, and then get in His Word and find out what He says to you, for you, and about you, and live victorious in this game we call a Christian life, and win every day. This game is fixed, I promise you. All this stuff that's common to man is easily overcome with the weapons that He has given us to operate in. And those weapons come straight out of God's Word. It's God's Word. Stand in it. Believe it. Believe it without a shadow of doubt. And watch the devil have to get out of your way. I promise you, he has to get out of your way if you'll just accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and find out who you are in Him. Glory to God. I thank God for the truth that He has given us in His Word to do that. Now, I want to thank you for tuning in. Thank you for taking the time to listen. I want to invite you to Church Alive at 6315 Mouse Creek Road. Come and see us. Yeah, I'm going to tell you something. You won't find a more loving group of people that wants to point you to God's Word. Glory to God. Don't forget, go to our website. It's the-prodigalson.com.